Hey, Jody here.
Today I'm going to build a knife out of a file. I know this has been done many times before, never seen it done the way I'm going to do it. Now the handle of a file is generally not hardened. I'm able to cut the handle with this file, so it's fairly soft. Softer than the cutting surface anyway. But it's still the same material. It's still hardenable. Files are made from things like 1095 carbon steel. A lot of times they won't tell you exactly what's in it. Sometimes it might have a little bit of chromium or a little vanadium or something like that in it for hardenability. The way to test hardenability easily is a quick puddle like this. You know it reaches transition temperature because it's melting. And that's like filing a ball bearing right there. That file is just slipping over it, not cutting at all. So it got a whole lot harder. And the reason that makes a difference for this video is I'm going to build up a bronze handle using aluminum bronze and silicon bronze. And because it's TIG brazing and not welding, I should be able to do this without exceeding the transition temperature in the area that would make it brittle and want to snap between the handle and the cutting surface. I'm using alternating current today because I find that really helps in not diluting any of the base metal in with the aluminum bronze. And incidentally, this is the way I repair a whole lot of cast iron parts too, with a preheat, but TIG brazing with aluminum bronze. It's stronger than silicon bronze, and when you use AC, it lets you wet a bead in without diluting hardly any base metal. And on high carbon steels and on cast iron, that's a big deal. Doing the same thing here, just sped up. And then I decided, you know, it's going to go a whole lot quicker with backing. I can just lay the heat to it and really pour the metal to it without it sagging over the edges if I put it against a piece of aluminum backing like this. I'll show that right here. See me just kind of pushing rod in there. I can go along at a nice slow speed, but I can feed a whole lot of rod in there. It traps argon. It doesn't let the bead sag anywhere. Having that aluminum backing. Now, if you use too thin of aluminum, it can easily melt the aluminum and kind of create a weld. It'll usually be brittle and snap right off, but you don't want that. So here it's just sped up, and I'm able to just, you know, periodically wire wheel, sand and whatnot to get a good clean surface so that it flows. And after I get a full layer of aluminum bronze on this thing with AC, I will switch to silicon bronze, really just mainly because I didn't have enough of either one to finish the job. And I like the idea of aluminum bronze for the first layer. That little bit of aluminum in aluminum bronze kind of retards hardening a little bit on that fusion layer, which is also a good thing on cast iron repairs. But after I get the first layer in and I run out of aluminum bronze, then I'll just switch over to silicon bronze and finish the job. It takes a lot of beads here, and I'm speeding this up a whole bunch. And I'm rushing it a little bit. You can see it's getting red hot here and there. But a funny thing happens when you're doing this, because of the bronze is so much more thermally conductive than the steel. Even though it's red hot, it's still pulling heat out of the steel. And the steel's not getting hot. I can hold the steel on the end no problem after even camping out for a long, long time here building this up. A little more contouring, putting it in a vise, touching it up here and there, and it'll be ready to put the finger pieces on. There are a lot of welding textbooks, and you can even find things online, like on blacksmith forums, that give you color temper charts. And according to what I saw, this is roughly where we're at here. So I only got a little bit over 800, even in that fusion area. So it should be slightly annealed maybe in that area, but not hardened. You may have heard me once or twice talk about going to FabTech. At the last FabTech, I got some samples of these Walther wheels, Enduroflex Alu. They're designed for aluminum to not load up with aluminum, but they work great for bronze too, as long as you keep it cool. It gets pretty hot, but they didn't load up at all. They took off a lot of material and left a good finish. So once I got that roughed out, I'm cutting some finger pieces here out of some, I believe this is 1¼-inch pipe, just depends on how big your fingers are. Making some marks there between them. And then I cut some pieces out so that it fit my fingers, the spacing better. And I'll get a few tack welds on that using silicon bronze. And then I mark the areas in between because I don't want to have to fill in those big, huge holes and possibly have voids and pockets and have it want to build up pressure and have all kinds of pinholes and stuff like that. So I'm kind of just really quickly slamming a lot of metal in there, and I'm going to grind it down. I get to a point to where those little areas are sort of filled up. That's manageable there. Using a little spacer piece to get things situated and centered up, I get this whole thing tacked up. Now, there's still a whole lot of TIG brazing to do. I want to put TIG braze everywhere on this thing because I want, basically, I don't want there to be any steel showing or very little steel showing. I'm going to sand it down. I'm going to polish it all up. Hopefully be nice and shiny and pretty when I'm done. And this is sort of patterned after the trench knives of World War I and World War II. You see them all over the internet. Some of them have skull breakers on the end like this and whatnot. But I'm just sort of patterning it after historical pieces, but then putting my own touch on it. Alternating heat here and there so that things don't get overheated, and just slamming a whole bunch of silicon bronze in there. I'm on DC now, by the way. Again, using that Walther wheel, getting things roughed out. And I decided to go ahead and tape the handle up and go ahead and work on the blade a little bit here before I get a polish on the handle, because I don't want to scratch it up. Picked up these at this last Fab Tech too. It's called a Walther Excavator. It's a ceramic hard rock. And I saw a demo at Fab Tech where it really removed a lot of material really quickly. So I thought it'd be a good idea to hog the material off, basically, using this thing. And it's working great, and it's actually not heating the piece up too much. But I'm still stopping every minute or so and squirting water on this blade to keep it cool. I don't want it to turn blue. I don't want it to lose hardness. It's going to lose a little bit. The next thing is to go to an 80 grit sanding disc with a backer pad on it. And I'm still trying to keep it cool. Still trying to, you know, keep things even and only go in one direction here. And it's coming along. I'm getting pretty close now. So I decided to put this 2-in-1 wheel on there. It's just like sanding pad sandwich between Scotch-Brite here on this. It leaves a good finish, but still removes quite a bit of material. So I'm working it down. I've heard that Windex helps in sort of keeping things cool and also keeping a wheel from loading up, so I thought I'd give it a try. But it's coming along. I'm getting pretty close to being done. These little things are abrasive cartridges. We used to call them Tootsie Rolls in the aerospace industry. Once I got all the finger holes sanded out, it's time to put a final polish on everything. You may have seen a lot of Walther in this video. I'm trying to show them some love because they did send me this polishing kit a year or two ago, and it's a nice one, and I haven't really said thank you a whole lot, so I'm using it here for this video, and that's my thank you. It's working great, though. There's a whole science to polishing, and they've got it down pat with the different steps you're using. I'm just kind of winging it for this video, getting a pretty good polish on everything. But I don't really want a super mirror finish because I'm going to use this thing. And if you get a super mirror finish, every little pit shows, every little scratch shows. I don't want that. But I do want this.